Hello student friends, let us have the last session of module 2, 8051 instruction set. In the previous sessions, we have learnt and discussed about the different addressing modes such as immediate type of addressing mode, register type of addressing mode, indirect type of addressing mode and implicit type of addressing modes. And later we have also learnt the directives such as EQ, ORG, END and so on. And we have learnt the instruction sets. The different types of instruction sets we have studied are the data transfer instruction set, data move instruction sets. Then we also have talked about the data processing instruction set, arithmetic instructions, logical instructions, control instructions and few implicit instructions. And we have also looked into the different examples in the process of understanding these instructions. In the today's class, we will be taking up a few full-fledged programs, okay, which uses all these instructions or most of these instructions in writing the program and understanding the logic. So let us move on to the next program. Write an ARM assembly or 8051 assembly program to perform the subtraction of two 16-bit numbers. So again, it's the same as we have done for the addition. In place of addition, we are going to use the subtraction. Okay, so we'll again have the data held at the location 40H. So wherein 40, 41 will be the first 16-bit number, 42, 43 will be the next 16-bit number. So in the program, I have again assumed in the similar way to say that lower address corresponds to lower byte and higher address corresponds to higher byte. So read the lower byte and you perform the subtraction. So here again, when you're performing the subtraction, the carry flag has to be cleared, because the instruction is only sub B. There is no separate instruction as only SUB without the borrow. Okay, the subtraction instruction is with the borrow. So for the lower 8-bit of subtraction, you do not have any borrow as such. I mean, the previous borrow is not there. So you have to clear off. You perform the subtraction, and if at all a borrow is being taken, then the carry flag will be set equal to 1 else 0. So as I said, it's the same program that goes here. Yeah, so here only instead of add, we will be writing it as sub B. Otherwise, the whole logic of the program remains to be the same. That is what we have. ORG 00, R0 pointing to the 40th, R1 to 42. Get the first number, clear the carry, perform the subtraction. A minus contents of accumulator minus the contents of the memory location pointed by the resistor R1. Okay, the result is put into accumulator, store it in the location 44. Increment R0 and R1, so 41 and 43 would be held in the register R0 and R1 respectively, which means the second byte of the data is to be subtracted, the higher second 16 bit. Perform the subtraction, and now if at all the borrow is taken for the lower subtraction, then that borrow would be considered for the higher byte of the subtraction. Okay, so that is how the program works. So we'll move on to the next program. Write an assembly program to count number of zeros and ones in an 8-bit number. So you have an 8-bit number, you have to count how many zeros and ones. So this program is basically taken to for us to understand the logical instructions to be used over here. So we'll get the first byte of we'll get a byte of data which is at the location 50H. Now you can observe here, in all these programs I have intentionally not fixed the value as a part of program. Always I have said that the data is there in the RAM location. The advantage of writing the program in this way is during the runtime you can change a different set of inputs and you can check for the your program, where your program fails, is it able to take all the possible input combinations or not. Okay, but if you fix up in the program itself, say as 50, instead of writing 50H, I will say the number is FF or 73. Then every time what you need to do, you have to exit from the debug mode into the edit mode, change the number and go back and check for the program with different set of test cases. But this is not really required. So at 50th H location, we have that 8 bit of the data. We rotate the 8 bit number right or left through carry. Anything is fine. Either you rotate it right through carry or left through carry. Now, if at all there is a carry that is being generated, it implies that there is a 1 in that particular location. So you increment a register which will hold the count of the number of 1s. Else you increment another register which will hold the count of the zeros. So repeat this for all the 8 bits. Okay. So here we have the program. Okay, this is taken at 50H. Yeah. So we'll say move R0, 50H. So here you have the number whose count of ones and zeros is to be checked. Now we are taking the counter here 8 because it's 8 bit. Okay, any number would be 8 bit and you're shifting or you're rather rotating bit by bit. So how many bits you have to rotate, you need to have a count of it. So get that number whose ones and zeros have to be counted into the accumulator. Then here I have used RLC. A, right? So in the carry, I will have rotate left, in the sense the most significant number would be there in the carry. If at all the carry bit is set JC, then you come to next. You are going to increment the number of ones. So in this program, R2 is a resistor which holds the number of ones and R1 is the resistor which holds the number of zeros. So if I take an example over here, let us assume that at the location 50H, say we have the number as 73H. Okay, so this 73 is written as 0111. And 3 is written as 0011. Fine. So when it comes to the RLC instruction, rotate left. So what happens to the carry? So once you rotate, the most significant bit is 0. So C will be equal to 0 in the first round. Okay, because this bit goes into the carry. Now this condition fails because the carry is not equal to 0. So what it does, it increments R1. So the resistor R1, right, would be equal to 1. Then SJMP down. So you decrement the resistor R7. So R7, which was 8, it becomes 7, goes back here. Again RLC. So in the next lot, what happens? C will be equal to 1. So when C is equals to 1, jump on carry. Yes, carry is equal to 1. It comes to the label that is next. So what are we doing here is we are incrementing the resistor R2, which holds the count of the number of 1s. So R2 will be equal to 1. Next left shift again, C will be equal to 1. So this 3 times C will be equal to 1. So this resistor R3 will increment by 3. That is for the higher nibble. Next again, you left shift, that time this is 0. So this becomes 2. Then again it is 0. R1 again becomes 3. The next two bits are both 1, 1, so R2 will be incremented by 4 and then finally 5. So at the end of this program, we will observe that the resistor R1, which is holding the number of zeros, will get the value of 3, and the resistor R2, which holds a number of 1s, will contain the value of 5 for the example that we have taken as 73. The next program is write an assembly program to find a given 8-bit number is odd or even. A very simple program. How do you check whether a number is odd or even? We will check by reading the least significant bit. So if the least significant bit is 0, we say that the number is even. And if the least significant bit is 1, then we say the number is odd. Same is the logic here. Assume that the number whose odd or even is to be found out can be put into the location 40. Copy that into the accumulator. And then we will check the 0th bit, whether it is 0 or 1. So when you load the accumulator, you can use JB instruction. That is jump on bit, the accumulator 0th bit, whether it is 1 or 0. So if at all it is odd, number is odd, then you store FF in the location 41, else store the value of 00. So here we have the program ORG00, R0 is 50H and okay, we are here, sorry, the 9th program. Okay, so R0 is 40H. So the content of the location 40H is copied into the accumulator. We use the instruction JB, jump if bit. Which bit are we checking? We are checking the 0th bit of the accumulator. If that bit is 1, okay, jump on bit. Or jump if the bit is 1 in the accumulator 0th bit of the accumulator, then go to the label that is odd. We say the number is odd. So we increment, we write the accumulator with a value of FF. So instead of accumulator, we would rather go with some resistor, say as R1. Or as per the program, I think we should be writing it in the location 41H. So we will write the FF or 00 into the location that is 41H. So if at all the number is odd, then it comes to the label that is odd. Why? Because the 0th bit of the accumulator is 1. Then the FF value is copied into the location which is 41H. But if this condition fails, that means the 0th bit is not 1, which means that it is 0, implies it is a even number. What we need to do then, we have to load the value of 0 into the 41st location. Right, so this is a program which helps us identify the number to be odd or even. The same program can be extended if you have 10 numbers, okay, and there you want to segregate the odd numbers and the even numbers. So the same logic can be taken up. Then what you need here is you simply need to increment to the next pointer, read that number, and you check again the 0th bit whether it is 1 or 0, and accordingly you can have either incrementing the number of odd and the even, or they can also be written in a separate location indicating all these numbers are odd numbers and then the even numbers. So this is for a single number, and this can be extended for a series of odd and even numbers to be separated. Now, the same program can also be used to check whether a number is positive or negative. What is the difference between odd and even? I mean, odd, even, and positive and negative. In case of odd or even, we check the least significant bit. And in case of positive or negative, we check for the most significant bit. Because we know that the most significant bit of the signed number indicates the sign of the number. So if the most significant bit is equal to 1, it indicates that the number is negative, else the number is positive. Okay, so that can be the extension. The 10th program that we have is write an assembly language program to generate 8-bit hex up counter. So what is that up counter? Hex up counter means it will start from 0, increment 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and so on till FF. That is what we call it to be as the hex up counter. So we will load accumulator with the 0, increment, and then there can be the delay instructions. Why? Because if you don't give the delay, then we will not be able to observe the increment that happens from 0 to 1, 1 to 2, 2 to 3 and so on. If no delay is being provided, then immediately after 00, you'll observe that it is simply FF. We will not be able to observe the intermediate values of increment that happens. Then if it is not a 0, then go to step 2 and repeat, else end the program. So ORG 00, move A comma 00. Now here explicitly I have used port 0. Why? Because there is a way of verifying the result even in the accumulator using the watch window. But here I just wanted to introduce how even port 0 can be used for such counter applications and so on. So whatever is the value A, it will be also put into the port 0. And if you go to the Kiel Microvision in the debug mode, peripheral, and select on IO port and port 0, you will see there you can observe that it keeps on incrementing. Okay, then A call delay. A call is instruction associated with the call to a subroutine. This would be taking up in the next session, but just remember there has to be some delay that has to be introduced. Okay, and this is the complete delay program that can be used. It's not a universal delay program, it's a normal delay program which I have used over here. So quickly to tell you how this function works is, R1 is loaded with the value of FF, R2 is also loaded with the value of FF, R3 again with FF. Then when you say DJNZ R3 comma dollar, so this is other way of labeling to itself. Okay, so instead of writing DJNZ R3 some S1 and give the label S1 to the same instruction, you can use dollar. That means that instruction points itself, repeat itself. Fine. So R3, this is going to repeat for FF times. Once it finishes, it comes. It decrements this R2 by 1 and it goes. So these two loops together will be FF into FF times. Next, again, these two together will be FF into FF into FF. And finally, it would be all three FFs that would be multiplied. So that becomes the total delay that would be generated. Now, this delay is not only the count that you provide. It also depends upon the number of clock cycles each of these instruction takes. And hence, the processor, since you're working on the Kiel Microvision, each of those processor will have some frequency of operation. All that will be incorporated to generate the required delay. Right. So in this program, what I have done is I have written for both, hex up counter as well as the down counter. So this one will give us the up count. And for the down count, you need to initialize A with FF, okay, and then put it into the port to see the value, call the delay function and decrement. So in case of up count, you'll be writing increment. In case of down count, you'll be writing it as decrement. Rest all, it remains the same. Here is what is the result obtained. I have put up. This is the program what we discussed. So you can see that port 0, it gives you the value. So as and when you execute the program, you'll observe that it keeps on incrementing from 0 to 1, 3, 2, 3, 4 up to FF. And then since decrement also is there, it becomes 0, then it will exit here. Reload with FF, decrement, then FF, FE, then FD, FC and so on till 0 and it stops. So both increment up and down, or rather up count as well as down count. The other one I was mentioning is to read the contents of the variables. So you can go to view and in the debug mode, we can go to view and there we can say watch window. The moment you add the watch window, in the enter expression, you have to write A, because A is the one which is incremented all the time or decremented depending upon up or the down count. So you can see here, this program I executed for some time and noted, took the snapshot of this, what you can see where P0 is 17. After some time, I took another snapshot of A, that's why you can see here to be as 47. Just to tell you that the program works as a up counter. So similarly, it will work even as a down counter. Then we have the last program to say as to perform the decimal up down counter. So what is the difference between the hex up down counter and a decimal up down counter? In the hex, the count will be from 0 to FF. Okay. While in case of the decimal up down counter, it is as good as a BCD counter, wherein it will count only from 0 to FF. So what we need to do over here, we cannot use a increment instruction, because die instruction will work only on addition. Fine. So what we need to do is we need to use the add instruction to increment. Fine, and then use the decimal adjust after addition. So whenever after incrementing or adding 1 to the previous number, the moment it becomes a hexadecimal, die instruction will convert it into a valid BCD. And hence we will be able to observe the output counting from 0 to 99. And for the down count, you can start from 99 and we can decrement. Okay. Right, here we have the program which does the job of performing the up count. P0 first loaded, you call the delay, same delay function I have used here. Add, it becomes 0, it becomes 1, used a, anyway it is not that effective. The moment it becomes 10, when you add 1 to 9, the answer should be 10, but it becomes A. Then the DA plays the role wherein it will add a value of 6 and you will be able to see that it becomes 10. So every time it's going to check the contents of the accumulator, J and Z. Remember, it works only with the accumulator. So the moment the content of the accumulator becomes 0, then again it goes back over here. So it repeats the whole lot again to perform the count. Okay, so this is how BCD up counter and up down counter can be worked upon. Hello students, today we'll have the revision of the content that is being delivered in module 2, which is 8051 instruction set. The objective of this session is basically to have the revision of the introduction to assembly language, the addressing modes that we have already studied, learnt, the assembly directives and the instruction set. So when we talk about an assembly language program, as we know, there are three types or three levels of programming. One is the machine language program. The other one you have is the assembly language. And then we have the high level language. The machine level language is the one which basically consists of ones and zeros, and it's a tedious job to write into. Then comes your high level language program. Fine, the high level language program is the C programming that you have already learned, or you'll be using it in most of the programming language programming. So the advantage of the C program is it's pretty simple, easy to understand. It's very simple, like a C program, with like an English language like program. Now, when we talk about the assembly language program, it is in between the high level language as well as the machine language. So it's neither completely similar to the English like language, nor it is a machine language. But when you program any architecture, right, at the assembly language, you are more nearer to the architecture, you're more near to the hardware. You can easily understand what is actually happening at the hardware. You need not directly go into the machine language, nor you do at the high level language. So you've got a lot of advantages when it comes to an assembly language program. One is you can go in for the optimization of the code, because when you write an assembly program, you will know how many clock cycles each instruction takes and how many bytes of the space, memory space, every instruction takes. So if at all you have an program which consists of say around 10 instructions, and on an average, the accumulation of all the instructions together, you will know how many bytes of memory space it takes. And hence, you know, there is a fixed number of clock cycles for every instruction it uses. So you'll know by the end of execution of the program, you'll say that, okay, this particular program requires X bytes of the memory space and it will be executing in Y times. Okay, it could be milliseconds, microseconds, depending upon the complexity of your program. So that's more advantageous to write an assembly language program. Then, that's what we discussed. What are the advantages of the assembly language program? But we do have, some disadvantage. What is a disadvantage? The disadvantage here is it becomes very specific to the architecture. Now, if at all I write a assembly program for 8051 architecture, I cannot directly use the same program for an ARM-based architecture or for a PIC microcontroller. Then the whole of the program has to be totally changed and it has to be rewritten for the different architectures. But that doesn't hold true when you write an high level, that is an embedded C program. When you write an embedded C program, you have the advantage of basically the portability, right? You write a program for 8051, then you think that, okay, let me develop the same application or a higher end microcontroller or for a 16-bit microcontroller. Then you have to make a slight modification in basically the programming registers that are being used and the header file that you'll be using. Okay, but nevertheless, you have got good advantages of assembly program, mainly when you write at the processor level, then this writing an assembly program is more advantageous. Now, what is the syntax of an assembly program? Like any other programming language, assembly language program also have a particular syntax. What the syntax is? The first one, you have it as a label. The label is a user-defined label, which is optional. Necessary not, every instruction will be associated with a label. Label is mainly used whenever there are control instructions to be used or whenever there is a call to a function, then you have the usage of this particular label. But the main structure of the program goes with the opcode, operand 1 and operand 2. As we have seen, 8051 is a two operand instruction, which means it just requires the source and the destination. And with respect to 8051, the first operand is always the destination, while the second operand is the source. Right, and the opcodes are nothing but you have been using different instructions, right? As add, move, then CPL, sub. Now for every of these mnemonic, there is an opcode that would be generated. So that is what we mean to be as the opcode. And the next, the last, but quite important is the comment. So always whenever we write an assembly program or any programming language for that matter, it's a good practice that we comment the program. So the moment we comment the program, it's advantageous for us as well as the other person who goes through our program. Now what is the advantage for us is we will be, when you write a program, some logic is there in our mind, right? So now that whole thing, if you write it as a comment, the logic is remembered. You need not again understand, or if you have forgotten the assembly program, you need not again go back and study those instructions. Now for the other person who is reading your program, needn't really know what are those instructions. Fine, he can simply go through the comments which explains the logic of your program, then it's helpful for him to know what is the program all about. So this is the syntax which would be followed in any assembly language program that we write. The next one, we will talk about the addressing modes. Now, what is the use of the addressing modes? Now, addressing modes basically tells from where the data is to be bought. Because if you look at the architecture of a microcontroller, you have got CPU registers or the programmable registers. There is a memory. And data can be there either obtained from the register for processing, or it can be from the memory. Now me and you can understand when you write an instruction, say as R1 comma A or A comma R1, that is the data is bought either from the register into accumulator or accumulator into register. Or we would have said move A comma hash some immediate data. For the controller to understand, find that the data is directly available as a part of instruction, or it has to be read from the register, or it has to be read from the memory location directly or indirectly, is all being defined by what we say to be as a addressing modes. So addressing modes basically specify the mode in which the data should be bought into for processing. So we have the different types of addressing modes. The first one, or one of the addressing mode, is the immediate type of addressing mode. So the immediate type of addressing mode is one wherein the source is a data which is well known, right? So as you can look into the example, it is move R0 comma hash 78. So the value 78 is that immediate value which is a part of the instruction. Now how do you differentiate that it is an immediate? A hash symbol is a must. Fine, you have to use a hash symbol if you have any definite data to be provided as the source input. And we need to remember that the immediate data or the definite value cannot be the destination. Like you cannot write move hash 78 comma R0. It is an invalid instruction. Now similarly, when you talk about the R0, you have providing only your 8-bit data. You can also write as move DPTR comma hash a 16-bit value. So if you are using a 8-bit register, obviously you're going to provide an 8-bit source as an immediate data. If you are using a 16-bit register, then a 16-bit data would be provided as a source of immediate data. The next one we have is the register type of addressing mode. So in the register type of addressing mode, the source and the destination are both registers. So they can either be an accumulator or it can be any register R0 to R7. But nevertheless, you cannot write the instruction as move DPTR comma A, which is invalid because DPTR is a 16-bit register and A is a 8-bit register. But you can use the instruction as A comma R6, I mean RN, or it can be RN comma A. The next one we have is the direct type of addressing mode. In this type of addressing mode, you can directly specify the address of the memory location. Like for example, if you see the first one, we have written move A comma 56H. Look at the difference in the first type of addressing mode, which is immediate, and the direct type of addressing mode. In the first one, you are specifying hash, which means that 78 is the immediate value that has to be moved into the register R0. But here, what is it? Now, this 56 will be the address of the memory location, and its contents would be copied into the accumulator. Okay, so here 56, or in the next example 45, 67, whatever we have shown here, they are the direct address. Which means in the direct type of addressing mode, either the source or the destination will be the direct address that is being specified, while the other can either be the accumulator or it can be the register R0 to R7. You can also use the move instruction wherein the source and the destination, both of them can be of the type direct. Like for example, you can say move 56, 45H, wherein 56 is also the address of a memory location and 45 is also the address of the memory location. The next one we have is the register indirect addressing mode. So in the direct addressing mode, you are providing the memory address directly. But here what we are doing is we are using register as a pointer to a memory location. Okay, as you can see in the first example, we have said move at the rate RI, A. Now what is this I stands for? Either 0 or 1. So we know that only R0 and R1 can be used as a pointer to a particular memory location. And in an indirect type of addressing mode, either it can be an accumulator, which can, through which the data can be bought, or it can be the direct. Now, what is the advantage of using this register indirect type of addressing mode? Now, in applications where you have got series of data to be read, a block of data that has to be read from a memory location, then instead of going in for the direct address where every time you need to keep on incrementing that address, you can simply go in for using this register indirect type of addressing mode. So it becomes pretty simple and accessibility also. The next one we have is the relative type of addressing mode. This addressing mode is basically used for the control instructions or call to a function. As you know, the whole of the jump instruction has got the range, relative range, or it is an absolute or a long. So there all the three types, that is relative type, the absolute and the long, are the ones which is supported in case of the relative type of addressing mode. So the relative type of addressing mode is the one supported for the control type of instructions. Hope you have recollected all about the addressing modes that we had discussed in our regular session. Now let us look into the instruction set. Now the instruction set of 8051 is divided into four category, or it has got four types. One is the data transfer, arithmetic, logical and control. So what we mean by data transfer is basically is used to transfer the data either between the registers, or it is between the register and memory, or between the memory, or you can also use the IO ports, the data being read from the ports into the accumulator or written onto the ports from the accumulator, which can either be directly or it can be indirectly. And the arithmetic type of addressing modes, they are the instructions which perform all arithmetic operations such as addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, for that matter even increment, decrement, all of them come under the category of arithmetic instruction. The next one we have is the logical instructions. So all the logical operations, we don't say all the logical, mainly they are the AND and the OR operations that are being used, and also the XOR ones are being supported as a part of logical instructions. And the AND operation and the OR operations support both at the bit level as well as at the byte level. Then finally, we have the control instructions. So the control instructions are either conditional or they are unconditional. We also have another category as call and return, mainly when it is for the subroutine. When you have a function to be called, then you need to have the instructions as A call, L call, right? And there has to be a return instruction. So that would be covered in our next module. Okay, so let us look into the address transfer instruction. So the instructions that are supported for the data transfer is move, move C, move X, push pop, exchange and XD. Now the move is a instruction which copies the data from the source into destination. So this is the instruction which supports all the types of addressing modes that we have discussed. Now, if at all you want to copy a data from the code memory or from the ROM location, then we have to use the instruction as move C, right? And this move C instruction is very typical. The syntax goes as move C at the rate a comma at the rate a plus dptr. So here it is the dptr which is being used as the base address and a acts as the offset address. So the effective address, that is a physical address, would be the addition of the contents of the DPTR plus the contents of the accumulator. And from that particular memory location, the data would be copied into the accumulator. So whenever you want to access the data from the code memory or the ROM location, then we go for using move C. Now, if at all the data is there in the external memory, right, you have an external RAM, fine, you want to get the data from there, then we use the instruction as move X. So X indicates external. So here it is again at the rate RI comma A or A comma RI. So if at all the external memory is a 8-bit address, then we'll go for using either the resistor R0 or the resistor R1. But if at all the external memory is a 16-bit address, then we go for using the DPTR. But we need to remember that whenever you're reading the data from the code memory or you're reading or writing the data to the external memory, it's always through the accumulator. No other resistors can be used to access the data from the memory, either the code or the external RAM memory. Then we have the next type of the data transfer, that is the operation stack related instructions. Now, what is a stack? Stack is a section of the memory which is mainly used as a temporary storage, and it performs the logic of last in first out, the LIFO. Now, when do we use this stack memory or the stack instructions? Say for example, you have written a program and there is an interrupt, right? Or there is a call to a function. Then what is expected? That the control has to be transferred to that particular function. But nevertheless, once you complete or once the controller completes that particular function, it has to come back to the main program. So there it has to retrieve back the contents of the registers. It has to retrieve back the contents of the program status word register, and it also has to retrieve back the program counter value. Then you will be using the stack as the medium to store all this data. So to store the data onto the stack, we use the instruction that is push, and to retrieve the data from the stack, we use the instruction pop. So here the default source or the destination is a stack memory, while the other operand is the direct address. You cannot use any register name as a part of the instruction. Like you cannot say push R0 or pop R0. Instead, you can write push 00, pop 00, which effectively does the same job, because 00 is the address associated with the register R0. So when you use the instruction push, what happens with the stack is the data is being pushed onto the stack, and the stack pointer, which is the top of the stack, is incremented, right? So it is first you push the data and then you increment. It's very similar to you stacking the pile of books. So when you stack the pile of books, already you have the level set, right? First you stack the book and then you have the, the label or the pointer attached. Stack, increment, that is how. But when it comes to the pop, you have to retrieve the data first and then you have to decrement the stack pointer. Fine. So in case of the push instruction, default destination is the stack And in case of the pop instruction, default source from where the data has to be popped is the stack. The next one we have is the exchange, data exchange related instructions, that is XCH. So this XCH is exchange. The data can be exchanged between the accumulator and indirect type of address through the resistor R0 or R1, or it can be also the direct address. Now XCHD does the exchange of the nibble. Okay, so if you want to swap the nibble of a resistor, mainly the accumulator, then we can go in for using XCHD. So these are all the instructions associated with the data transfer instruction. Next, let us look at the arithmetic type of instructions. In the arithmetic instructions, we have addition, increment, decrement, subtraction, multiplication, and division. Now, most of these instructions will affect the flag. Now, which are the flags that get affected? Either it is the carry flag, or it is the overflow flag, or it is the auxiliary flag. Now, when you talk about the addition type of instructions, it is add, add C, and DA. Add is the normal addition that happens between the source and the destination, and the result is put back into the destination. Now the destination is the accumulator, while the other right source can be a resistor, it can be an immediate data. When you want to add the contents of the flag also, then we use the instruction add C. Now what is the use of this add C? It is basically used whenever you want to perform the addition of, say, 16-bit data or a 32-bit data, wherein the next consecutive 8-bit of the data needs to consider the carry that is being generated by the previous byte addition. So there we will be using add C. And DA is decimal adjust after addition. So the instructions add and add C will give us the result in a hexadecimal. But if at all you want the result in a decimal, that is in a BCD, you give the input as BCD and you want the result also to be as a BCD, then we have to use the instruction DA. So this is the most important instruction. How this instruction basically works is, I'll elaborate a little bit. So it works on the nibble. So when it performs the addition of two BCD numbers, it checks for the lower nibble. So if at all the lower nibble is greater than 9, then it adds 06. This is the first condition. What is the first condition? It checks whether after addition the lower nibble is greater than 9. It adds 06. The second condition is the addition may not be greater than 9, but the auxiliary carry may be set. So if the auxiliary carry is being set, then also it adds 06. So for the lower nibble, what are the two conditions? The first condition is it checks whether the result of the lower nibble is greater than 9 or the auxiliary carry flag is being set to add 06. Then it checks for the higher nibble. The condition here is, again, it checks the result of the higher nibble, whether it is greater than 9. If it is greater than 9, then it adds 60. If it is not greater than 9, then it checks for the carry flag. If the carry flag is set, then also it will add 60. This is how the DA instruction converts a non-BCD number into a valid BCD number or into a valid decimal number. The next instruction that we have is increment and decrement. So the mnemonics that we have is INC and DEC. So it simply increments by a value of 1 with whatever the operand that you have specified. When you say decrement, it decrements by 1. Increment has a support for DPTR instruction. But decrement, you do not have a support for DPTR. That means you cannot use the instruction as DEC DPTR. It's an invalid. But nevertheless, you know that DPTR consists of two resistors, that is DPH and DPL. Their direct addresses are known to us. So you can directly use the address of either DPL or DPH along with the instruction DEC, and you can use it. So effectively, it does the same job of either decrementing the DPTR higher byte or the lower byte. The next instruction we have is the sub B. Now, if you look at the add instruction, it has got two different ones, that is add and add C separately with the carry and without carry. But subtraction, there is no difference. Default, it will consider borrow as a part of the subtraction. So when you do not want the borrow as a part of the subtraction, then what you need to do is you basically have to clear off the carry flag. The next two instructions, that is multiplication and division, they perform the multiplication and division with only two resistors, that is A and B, which means that when you use the instruction mul, it is going to perform the multiplication of the contents of the accumulator and the B resistor. And that complete 16 bit of the data would be stored back again into the accumulator and the B resistor. When it is division, it performs A by B because this instruction is div AB. So it performs 8 by 8, 8 bit by 8 bit division. Then finally, the quotient would be there into accumulator, and B resistor would contain the remainder. So these are all the instructions associated with the arithmetic operations. The next one we have is the logical instructions. So the logical instructions, we have AND, OR, and the XOR. So we know AND operation performs either bitwise or bytewise. OR is also bitwise or bytewise. So when it is a byte, it can either be an accumulator or the direct address. Okay, as a destination, it cannot be anything else. But a source can either be a resistor, immediate or indirect. Now, when you're performing the bitwise AND or operation, it is always with the carry flag. Fine. That means your source, the destination is ANL C, bit address. And this bit address is the address of the bit addressable memory, or it is the bit addressable port, or it is the bit addressable SFRs. Only those have to be specified over there. But the XOR operation does only with the byte. It does not support the bit. But it does not require to perform it. There is no need. It does not support the bit level. The next one we have is the clear A, as well as clear bit. So clear A basically clears the contents of the accumulator. And when you say clear bit, it is again the bit address. So the address that you specify here, its contents would be cleared off. Next is the CPL, that is complement. Either it is accumulator or it is carry or it is the bit address. So the contents of accumulator, if there are one, it becomes a zero, or combination. Basically it performs one's complement. Similarly, carry, if it is 0, it is 1, 1, it will be 0. The next one we have is the rotate instruction. So the rotate instruction supported is right rotate as well as left rotate with carry and without carry. And all these instructions will be operated on the accumulator only. Okay, would be with the accumulator only. The next one we have is the swap instruction. Swap basically does the nibble swap. Okay, when you use swap A, the lower nibble and the higher nibble would be swapped across. Fine. So this is how the instruction works. The next one we have is the control instruction. Now, when you talk about the control instruction, let us quickly look at the range of the jump. So the range of the jump is either relative absolute or the long jump. When it is relative, the range is just between plus 128 to minus 127. So all the conditional bitwise as well as the byte level fall under the category of relative. Then you say absolute, it is within the 2K page. So there the program counter would require 11 bits of the program counter 11 bits would be changing based on the page and the internal location, while the remaining more significant bits remain unchanged. And when it is long jump, you have got the complete 64 bit of the memory space where the control can be transferred. So there the program counter will be holding the complete 16 bit address. Now, when you talk about the control instructions, you have unconditional as well as conditional. So the unconditional is S jump, A jump and J jump. So default, without any condition being checked, the control would be transferred to the specified label. But when it comes to an conditional jump, either it is bitwise or bytewise. When it is bitwise, it mainly operates with respect to the carry flag or the bit addressable bit. Okay, that is the value in the bit addressable memory registers or the SFRs. Like for example, JC, JNC, it checks for the carry flag. So this, the control would be transferred to the label in JC if carry flag is 1. In JNC, if the carry flag is 0. Then when you say JB, it means you are specifying the bit address as one of the operand. Okay, so if at all the bit in that particular bit address, if it is 1, then the control would be transferred. Similarly, when you say JNB, if the bit is 0, then the control would be transferred. And when it comes to JBC, you check whether the bit is 1. If so, you clear off that particular bit and then you transfer the control to the specified label. When it is bytewise, it is JZ, JNZ. So these two instructions basically check for the 0 flag. And these two instructions operate only on the accumulator contents. They do not check for any register contents. So if at all you want to check the contents of the register, then you can use this cumulative instruction, that is DJNZ. So what this instruction does, it decrements the specified register and it checks whether the contents of that specified register is 0 or not. If it is not 0, then the control would be transferred to the specified label. CJNE, it basically compares the two operands specified. If the two operands are not equal, then the control would be transferred. So when it is not equal, it means that either the first number is greater than the second number or first number is less than the second number. Okay, so we have covered all contents that we had done in the module 2, right from understanding what is an assembly program, what are the addressing modes and so on. Okay, so with this we will wind up with the module 2. Hope you are able to follow all the sessions that we took up. For any queries, as I said, you can very well get back to me either on my email as rupa.patwardhan@gmail.com, or you can contact me over my number 9880156678. And then we have also talked about a lot of programs, many programs we have learnt and understood. So with this fundamental programming that we have done in this module 2, you should be comfortably able to complete your lab assignments, most of the programs, as well as the programs to write on your own. Okay, so thank you one and all for your patience listening throughout the sessions that I have taken of module 2, that is instruction set, 8051 instruction sets. Thank you once again.